Well, I don't agree at all. First off, how is it possible that anybody with any kind of sanity would consider the United States or Britain or the West in general to be in any kind of position to be punishing anyone for any illegalities?
The police the same way. They put their club upside your head and then turn around and accuse you of attacking them. Every case of police brutality against a Negro follows the same pattern. They attack you, bust you all upside your mouth, and then take you to court and charge you with assault.
Okay, now they know they got the wrong guy, okay? And they beat the crap out of him, and by the way, he got a concussion, too, on top of everything else. So then they bring it, and then they say, well, we got to charge him with something, right? Oh, you bet we bled on our uniform while we were kicking the living crap out of you and pummeling you. So that's property damage to my uniform. Okay, there you go. We charge you with something.
If we want to take a look at Iraq, there is at least 1 million, probably even close to 2 million dead. We invaded that country, destroyed it, created millions of orphans, millions of refugees, and never even so much as apologized for that. Let's go back to Vietnam, where we dropped 20 million bombs, more than all of World War II combined. We have destroyed so many countries. We have tortured and killed and maimed and raped around this planet. Who in the hell in their right mind would consider the United States or the West in general to be in any position to punish anybody? Never mind the obvious facts that this is a false flag attack and a long list of false flag attacks, which let's get into that, please.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a murderer, a liar, and a thief. I have sown so many lies throughout history. I have enslaved and subjugated many people. I am responsible for mass genocides throughout the entire planet. I have created evil inventions that destroy, kill, and pollute the world you live in. I have went into many nations and robbed them of their natural resources. I have contaminated your soil, water, food, and even the air you breathe. The whole world marvels after me. This is why I can do such evil in their sight. Who am I?
Most employers rely heavily on resumes or background checks to determine whether or not an individual is suited for a position. It's highly unlikely that someone with a history of drunk driving would be hired to drive a school bus, or that someone with a history of child abuse would be hired as a daycare worker. Many of the problematic events we see happening in our world today are linked to a number of factors. However, if we take a realistic look at things, we would all come to the same conclusion. From the failing infrastructure and contaminated water to air pollution, we can follow the trail back to the dominance of one particular group. Never in our world's history have we faced so much uncertainty. Fracking, drilling, nuclear plants, sewage systems, plastic contaminants, chemical fertilizers, GMO foods, and more are the major causes of mass animal deaths, large fish die-offs, birds falling from the sky, foodborne illnesses, sinkholes, birth defects, and more. If evidence has shown that elements and events of our past are still playing out today in a major way, is it safe to say that the same mindset still exists? Does covert activity null the facts that we see right before our eyes? It is my belief that the world has been blinded by what we are forced to believe, based on the perceptions presented by a few, and what our own hearts imagine, even if it's all lies.
Oh,
On a daily basis, we are bombarded with images of people that the West Europeans refer to as terrorists, thugs, and savages. But those that are making such reports fail to include their track record and the background of their own people. Let's go back in history and uncover the truth and expose the lies that were hidden. If you carefully look at the things that were done to blacks in slavery, you can see just how it has totally affected the lives of the blacks in America. Black families suffered greatly as a result of white slave masters raping the black women. She no doubt felt like her husband was helpless and that he could not protect her or her daughters. The black man, no doubt he was feeling like he couldn't defend his family. Just imagine how he felt and how they felt after the master was done violently raping his wife.
The picture, y'all. Why don't everybody smile?
Addie, come on. I need your help in the shed. Come on.
Pop, will you take him off?
Get back to work.
Cease! Come back here, boy.
Mama!
Come here.
Look at me, boy. Don't you lose your temper with that man. This is world. We just living in it. You hear me? Now get on back to work.
Hey.
Must have been devastating to that family. The psychological effect on them must have been very overwhelming. The Willie Lynch letter has made quite a stir in the minds of black people. And though the letter has not yet been validated, it clearly shows the full effects of slavery that have played out on the lives of black people, just like it states in the infamous Willie Lynch letter.
Gentlemen, you know what your problems are. I do not need to elaborate. I am here to introduce you to a method of solving them. In my bag here, I have a foolproof method of controlling your black slaves. I guarantee every one of you that if installed correctly, it will control the slaves for at least 300 years. My method is simple. Any member of your family or your overseer can use it. I have outlined a number of differences among the slaves, and I take these differences and make them bigger. I use fear, distrust, and envy for control purposes. These methods have worked on my modest plantation in the West Indies, and it will work throughout the South. Take this simple little list of differences and think about them. On top of my list is age, but it's there only because it starts with an A. The second is color or shade. There is intelligence, size, sex, sizes of plantations, status of plantations, attitude of owners where the slaves live in the valley, on the hill, east, west, north, south, how fine hair, coarse hair or is tall or short. Now that you have a list of differences, I shall give you an outline of action. But before that, I shall assure you that distrust is stronger than trust and envy stronger than adulation, respect, or admiration. The black slaves, after receiving this indoctrination, shall carry on and will become self-refueling and self-generating for hundreds of years, maybe thousands. Don't forget, you must pitch the old black males versus the young black male and the young black male against the old black male. You must use the dark-skinned slave versus the light-skinned slaves and the light-skinned slaves versus the dark-skinned slaves. You must use the female versus the male and the male versus the female. You must also have white servants and overseers who distrust all blacks. But it is necessary that your slaves trust and depend on us. They must love, respect, and trust only us. Gentlemen, these kits are your keys to control. Use them. Have your wives and children use them. Never miss an opportunity. If used intensely for 1 year, these slaves themselves will remain perpetually distrustful.
Make a slave. Yeah, I'm gonna take you back in the days to them slave masters. I'm gonna explain how to make a slave. Listen, I've got this big old house, living larger than ever. Bought some slaves at the auction, work hard, they better. Cause I've got this lever, wire lace, bullwhip. I'll tie to the tree and I'll beat that nigga. Best call me master, best call me sir. I ship them in from Africa. And I'll even use the Bible as part of my plan and teach them that they the son of Ham. Cause Ham had a son that was cursed to be a slave and serve his brothers for the rest of his days. Make you my slave, you don't like it, oh well. A white man's heaven is a black man's hell. I brainwash them well by changing the scripture. Send them to church, make them praise my picture. Cause I'ma put a picture of myself as the savior. So looking up to me is just a part of their nature. Take away their history, take away their past, take away their culture, kick them in the ass. Read a book in class, made so much sense, called Making of a Slave by Willie Lynch. And will I lynch? You damn right, sonny. I'll even kill some children in front of their mummy. Cause that'll make their mother wanna protect her seed. And fear will make her raise them to do what I need. And she'll breed that thought into future generations. And future generations will breed the same thoughts into future generations. Slave mentality will soon become just a part of their personality. And that mentality will get passed along. So they'll keep suppressing each other when I'm gone. And that'll carry on till the end of days. So I can sit back while the slaves make the slaves make the slaves that make you the slave. Run, run.
When you see riots in the city of Detroit in 1967, and the Rodney King riots of 1992, and the riots that's going on in Ferguson, Missouri, you think that riots originated from blacks, but this isn't so. There were actually riots in Rome, and can be recorded as far back as 44 BC. Most of what you see done by blacks and other non-whites is considered an insurrection due to some type of injustice. But what most whites have done throughout history have been race riots based on lies, hatred, and pure jealousy. History is packed with many riots and massacres of whole communities, lynchings and murderings of innocent women and children, all done by white people.
As blacks began to seek their freedom in the late 1800s, riots began becoming more frequent. Blacks and other ethnic groups started to set up their communities among whites, and tensions began to flare. Here are just a few of the riots and massacres that occurred from 1866 to the early 1900s. The Bellingham riots occurred on September 4, 1907, in Bellingham, Washington, USA. A mob of 400 to 500 white men, members of the Asiatic Exclusion League, with intentions to exclude East Indian immigrants from the workforce, attacked the homes of the South Asian Indians. The Robert Charles riots of 1900, a total of 28 blacks were killed in the riots. The Meridian Race Riot of 1871, which involved Freeman, a former slave that was killed, whites killed as many as 30 blacks. The Chinese Massacre of 1871 in Los Angeles, when a mob of over 500 white men entered Chinatown to attack, rob, and murder Chinese residents of the city. 18 Chinese immigrants were killed by the mob. The Memphis Riots of 1866. Mobs of white civilians and policemen rampaged through black neighborhoods and the houses of freed men, attacking and killing men, women, and children. 46 blacks and 2 whites were killed, 75 blacks injured, over 100 black persons robbed, 5 black women raped, and 91 homes, 4 churches, and 8 schools burned in the black community by a white mob. The New Orleans Riot of 1866 was a violent conflict in which whites attacked blacks parading outside the Mechanics Institute in New Orleans. Casualties were estimated at 38 killed and 46 wounded, most of them black. The Springfield Race Riot of 1908 was a mass civil disturbance in Springfield, Illinois. The mob rioted in black neighborhoods, destroying and burning black-owned businesses and homes, and killing black citizens. The Chicago Race Riot of 1919 was a major racial conflict that began in Chicago, Illinois, on July 27, 1919, and ended on August 3rd. During the riot, 38 people died and over 500 were injured. It is considered the worst of the approximately 25 riots during the Red Summer, so named because of the violence and fatalities across the nation. The combination of prolonged arson, looting, and murder was the worst race rioting in the history of Illinois. The Knoxville Riot of 1919. According to the National Guard, the death toll was between 30 and 40. Others placed the death toll in the hundreds. By some accounts, the dead were so many that the bodies were dumped into the Tennessee River, while others were buried in mass graves outside the city. The Omaha Race Riot of 1919. The race riot resulted in the brutal lynching of Will Brown, a black worker, the death of 2 white men. It followed more than 20 race riots that occurred in major industrial cities of the United States during the Red Summer of 1919.
I'm a murderer, a liar, and a thief.
Turn your back on me when I talk!
Damn swamp tramp! What you crying about? What you think you're doing here, me? You little swamp tramp! You little swamp tramp! You little nigga! Get on it! Get on it! Get on it!
Girl?
Melody! Nigga! It was a nigga! He broke in my house and he beat me up. It was a nigger, it was. I beat badly, badly. He was so big. He's so black, that boy.
She said she was raped.
Shut up, y'all. Everybody go on out of here. Show's over. You heard me.
Bree, a white woman in a town 2 miles from here, Fannie Taylor was her name, accused a black man of attacking her. It was not true, but the people believed it, and this brought a tremendous mob of white people to Rosewood, and over a period of about 4 or 5 days, they burned the town down and killed at least 8 people and possibly more.
Rosewood being a town in the South where blacks was making some progress, where they owned their own little sawmills and their little stores, and they was kind of like the role models, and they was leading by example.
The date was June 1st, 1921, when Black Wall Street, the name fittingly given to one of the most affluent all-black communities in America, was bombed from the air and burned to the ground by mobs of envious whites. In a period spanning fewer than 12 hours, a once thriving 36-block business district in northern Tulsa lay smoldering, a model community destroyed and a major African-American economic movement resoundingly diffused. The night's carnage left some 3,000 African-Americans dead and over 600 successful businesses lost. Amongst these were 21 churches, 21 restaurants, 30 grocery stores, and 2 movie theaters, plus a hospital, a bank, a post office, libraries, schools, law offices, and a half dozen private airplanes, and even a bus system. As could be expected, the impetus behind it all was the infamous Ku Klux Klan working in consort with ranking city officials and many other sympathizers. The description of Black Wall Street, or Little Africa as it was also known, would be to liken it to a mini Beverly Hills. It was the golden door of the black community during the early 1900s, and it proved that African Americans had successful business infrastructure. That's what Black Wall Street was all about.
The 13th anniversary of the worst attack on American soil. September 11th, 2001. We must remember that day. We must always remember that day. We must never put it behind us. We must never say, well, it's in the past. Let's move on. We can never move on. The other thing that we must remember is that we're not any safer today, maybe less safe than we were on that day. And part of the reason is because this administration has eviscerated our military. We've not gone after our enemies, and our southern border is wide open.
Matt, what happened in 9/11 was a crime against humanity, and America should always remember that and work diligently to make sure that that never happens again. But no government can keep its population totally 100% safe. So we must do our due diligence to send a message to those terrorists that if you're successful in striking America, we will hunt you down like the criminals you are, and you will pay the consequences. But also, I think that we should do a better job in this country of educating the American public. The first time that airplanes were used to kill hundreds and potentially thousands of people in this country was not September the 11th. It was in the 1930s in Tulsa, Oklahoma, when on a Sunday afternoon, white people who were jealous of the prosperity of an entire black community got in airplanes and bombed their people and killed hundreds. And some studies say up to 4,000 African Americans were murdered in Tulsa, Oklahoma using airplanes.
What has that got to do with 9/11? What has that got to do with what the hell we're talking about?
Because you said, how do we remember? And what I want you to understand is we should remember 9/11 the same way we remember Tulsa, Oklahoma, and what happened with that terrorist act against black people.
Let me explain something to you, Quanell. These people in the Middle East, like ISIS, they want to kill you. They want to kill me. They want to kill your kids. They want to kill everybody. So instead of making this a racist argument, let's talk about Americans. We're all Americans, right?
And Matt.
So let's protect
the hundreds, potentially thousands that were murdered in Tulsa, Oklahoma, were Americans being murdered and slaughtered by terrorists who were Americans also. So don't tell me that when white people are slaughtered in New York, and yes, they were, and black people died too.
What are you talking about?
All races died in New York.
There were Catholics, there were Muslims, there were Jews, there were Asians, whites and blacks.
Yes, a crime against humanity. But remember, the first time it happened was when you did it to black people in Oklahoma using airplanes. Chickens come home to roost whether you like it or not.
Wow, man. You know what? The reason why this country is in such dire shape,
Matt,
is because people like you
educate
have
the
lost
American
focus
public
on what made this country great.
And America, they didn't make this country great. Everybody in this country made America great, but pay all of its citizens the correct homage and treat all of us equal. The first terrorists were not them from Arabs. It was right here in America.
Notice how he says we must always remember, we must never forget. So when something happens to them in large, everyone is expected to remember, everyone is expected to feel sorrowful or to feel some type of anguish for them. But when you want to talk about what they have done to you, that's where the problem comes in. They tell you these words. We hear these words all the time. Get over it. That's in the past. Or my ancestors did that, not me.
Thus saith the Lord my God, feed the flock of the slaughter, whose possessors slay them, and hold themselves not guilty. And they that sell them say, blessed be the Lord, for I am rich, and their own shepherds pity them not.
The level of hypocrisy we see today is astounding.
We must remember that day. We must always remember that day. We must never put it behind us. We must never say, well, it's in the past, let's move on. We can never move on. We must remember that day. We must always remember that day. We must never put it behind us. We must never say, well, it's in the past, let's move on. We can never.
I am Satan, and I have a seed upon this earth. Children, my own offspring. They are just like their father. My children do the works of their father. They lie and deceive just like me. In Genesis, it says, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. There is hatred between the woman's seed and my seed, between her children and my children. My children are just like me. They steal, kill, and destroy. Just look around, and you will know them by their works.
Christopher Columbus was not the first to discover the Americas, nor was he the first to realize that the Earth is round. He was the first, however, in other exploits, namely genocide and the transatlantic slave trade. In 1492, Columbus discovered the Americas when he landed in Haiti and several islands in the Caribbean. The Arawak Indians inhabited these islands. For the second voyage to Haiti, the following year, 1493, Ferdinand and Isabella gave him the resources needed to subdue the population. When he returned to Haiti, Columbus demanded food, gold, and cotton thread, and was increasingly met with resistance. This resistance gave him the opportunity he needed to declare war on the Arawaks. With 20 hunting dogs, horses, and guns, Columbus set upon the Arawaks, tearing them up with dogs and mowing them down with volleys of bullets and running them over with horses. Reporting back to Queen Isabel of Spain, Columbus boasted, "In the name of the Holy Trinity, we can send from here all the slaves that Brazil will hold." The Spaniards hunted Indians for sport and murdered them for dog food. Columbus would reward his officers with women to rape. Girls 10 to 12 were especially desired for rape. Columbus and the Spanish won the war, and over 3 million Arawaks were killed in the genocide. They completely robbed the land of its gold. This is the truth about Columbus that's not recorded in your history books.
On the other hand, most Americans know today is Columbus Day, at least in 47 states, although Hawaii has renamed it Discoverer's Day after the original Polynesians who populated that island thousands of years ago. South Dakota calls it Native American Day, and Alaska just ignores it like they kind of do everything. But what we're really celebrating today is Taino Genocide Day, the day when Christopher Columbus began to wipe out an entire indigenous population in a way that would even make Pol Pot blush. In 1492, Columbus was on a manic hunt for gold when he set sail and eventually landed on a small island off the coast of North and South America, an island today named Hispaniola, which is split between the nations of Haiti and the Dominican Republic. As Columbus wrote in a letter to the King and Queen of Spain, "Gold is most excellent, gold constitutes treasure, and he who has it does all he wants in the world and can even lift souls up to paradise." But when he landed in what he called the New World, there wasn't much gold to be found. But he did find something he thought was just as good as gold, people who, in Columbus's mind, would make great slaves. So he wrote to the Spanish monarchs, They are well built, with good bodies and handsome features. They do not bear arms and do not know them, for I showed them a sword, and they took it by the edge and cut themselves out of ignorance. They have no iron. Their spears are made of cane. They would make fine servants. With 50 men, we could subject them all and make them do whatever we want. And here there are so many of these slaves. Although they are living things, they are as good as gold. What Columbus did to the island and the tragedy he brought to the native population there has been largely erased by time and replaced by a glorified story of a bold explorer who set out to change the planet. In reality, though, as a result of what we've learned from writings by Christopher Columbus's own men, he raped, pillaged, enslaved, and slaughtered people just to get rich. Not exactly the type of guy worthy of a Main Street parade. One of Columbus's crewmen, Miguel Cueno, described the scene when Columbus first arrived in Hispaniola for the second time, and thousands of Taínos, or what were referred to as Indians, came out to greet the ships. Cueno wrote, "When our caravels were to leave for Spain, we gathered 1,600 male and female persons of these Indians. For those who remained, we let it be known to the Spaniards in the vicinity that anyone who wanted to take some of them could do so to the amount desired, which was done." Cueno went on to write that he took his own sex slave, a beautiful teenage girl who, in his words, quote, "resisted with all her strength," quote, end quote, leaving him no other choice but to, quote, "thrash her mercilessly and rape her," end quote. And when Columbus's men did good work, Columbus routinely presented them with their very own sex slaves. But that was just the beginning. Columbus eventually started up a global child sex slave trade, exporting Indians all around the world, as he bragged to a friend in a letter written in 1500. 100 castellanos, is a Spanish coin, are as easily obtained for a woman as for a farm. And it is very general, and there are plenty of dealers who go about looking for girls. Those from 9 to 10 years old are now in demand. Eventually, under Columbus's orders, life for the Taíno on their homeland of Hispaniola became so bad that they resorted to mass suicide. As the Spanish missionary Pedro Cordoba noted in 1517, 25 years after Columbus arrived, as a result of the sufferings and hard labor they endured, the Indians choose and have chosen suicide. Occasionally, 100 have committed mass suicide. The women, exhausted by labor, have shunned conception and childbirth. Many, when pregnant, have taken something to abort and have aborted. Others, after delivery, have killed their children with their own hands so as not to leave them in such oppressive slavery. By the time Cordoba wrote those words, the indigenous population on Hispaniola had plummeted from roughly 3 million people before Columbus arrived to only 12,000 25 years later. A few decades after that, not one Taíno was left on the island. An entire culture and people completely wiped off the map and largely forgotten, thanks to Christopher Columbus. Happy Taíno Genocide Day.
In 1995, Russell Means, a Native American activist, wrote a book called Where White Men Fear to Tread, the autobiography of Russell Means. In his book, he states that, when we met with the Wampanoag people, they told us that in researching the history of Thanksgiving, they had confirmed the oral history passed down through their generations. Most Americans know that Massasoit, chief of the Wampanoag, had welcomed the so-called Pilgrim Fathers and the seldom-mentioned Pilgrim Mothers to the shores where his people had lived for centuries. The Wampanoag now wanted to remind white America of what had happened after Massasoit's death. Massasoit was succeeded by his son, Metacomet, whom the colonists called King Philip. In 1675 to 1676, to show gratitude for what Massasoit's people had done for their fathers and grandfathers, the Pilgrims manufactured an incident as a pretext to justify disarming the Wampanoag. The whites went after the Wampanoag with guns, swords, cannons, and torches. Most, including Metacomet, were butchered. His wife and son were sold into slavery in the West Indies. His body was hideously drawn and quartered.
For 25 years afterward, Metacomet's skull was displayed on a pike above the White's village. The real legacy of the Pilgrim Fathers is treachery. Most Americans today believe that Thanksgiving celebrates a boar harvest, but that is not so. By 1970, the Wampanoag had turned up a copy of a Thanksgiving proclamation made by the governor of the colony. The text revealed the ugly truth. After a colonial militia had returned from murdering the men, women, and children of an Indian village, the governor proclaimed a holiday and feast to give thanks for the massacre. He encouraged other colonies to do likewise. In other words, every autumn the crops are in. Go kill Indians and celebrate your murders with a feast. In 2006, Kevin Annett produced a documentary called Unrepentant, Canada's Genocide. This documentary chronicles the deliberate genocide of Canada's Indigenous people and exposes the kidnapping, torture, rape, and murder of tens of thousands of Native Americans in Canada. From early colonization and the first use of biological warfare, to church-run residential schools, to the ongoing theft of resource-rich Native land, it's estimated that over 50,000 children were murdered.
I know a lot of you people out there don't understand, but there is a need for the world to know about this. Because the church is hiding and the government's hiding. There is a lot of people that died in those places.
Did they put you in a hospital?
Yes, I did. Well, yeah, you give me some drugs or something like that.
What kind? What happened to you?
I don't know what kind of drug it was.
What happened to you when they gave you the drugs?
Hey, oh, yeah, put me in there, like a padded room. Padded room, like? I was strapped down.
That was after you reported the girl?
Yeah.
Finding the girl's body?
Yeah.
I'd seen them burn hands of kids when they're 3 years old and five, with a little spike in their hand and zoom, like that, like a shock thing.
Electric shock?
Yeah.
Device? Why did they shock the kids?
Because the kids wouldn't listen to the Catholic priests.
He used it on my brother's penis. He electrocuted his penis there till my brother passed out. And he was laughing, brother. My brother said he was laughing while he was doing it. You'd like to see him in pain, I guess.
Never at any point when I was pleading with them to stop what they were doing to my family and I, even on that level of just how it impacted me personally, there wasn't a shred of humanity in them. They were like...
You were looking in their eyes, nothing there.
Nothing. Absolutely nothing. So you know what? When that happened to me, I realized, up until then, you know, like any of us, it's somewhat abstract. People tell you stories and you keep wondering, well, how could they do this? When I saw what they were able to do to me, one of their own, when they turned and shredded my life mercilessly and allowed my 6 and 2 year old daughter to go through hell, I thought, if they could do that to me, imagine what they could do to a Native child who wasn't a Christian, who was dark skinned, who wasn't part of them. Of course they could kill them.
So I watched. And she was standing at the top of the stairs, and he kicked her. She went rolling downstairs. She ended up, she was laying like this. Her eyes were open, but she wasn't moving. She wasn't crying. So I see that all the time.
Her name was Maggie. She was 2 years older than me, and she was murdered in there by a nun. Pushed out the window, second story up, and she died. But nothing was done about it. We weren't allowed to see a lawyer or nothing. They just covered this up.
Jenny wouldn't cry out, and all of a sudden, this blood just spurred all over the place, and on her, just on her back, and a small part of her back. They had opened up
I'm not.
It's the last time I ever saw my sister.
That's where the ministers all get together to talk over church matters. And at that presbytery meeting, the whole issue of how land was taken from the Miyahuasa's people was basically covered up and denied by the church. So I took issue with that, and I wrote this letter. Subsequently, I was fired from my pulpit. The letter is dated October 17, 1994, and it's addressed to the members of Comox Nanaimo Presbytery. Dear members of Presbytery, I am writing this in the wake of the brief discussion at the Fall Presbytery Gathering in Gold River concerning the issue of the Ahouset's land settlement. I am both deeply concerned about the response of Presbytery officials to this issue and the way in which this matter was dealt with at Presbytery. My perspective on this issue arises largely as a result of long and fruitful discussions with the Ahouset's, including with several tribal elders. The issue seems to be one of violated trust on our part, rather than any legalistic or documentary problem, as Presbytery officials have suggested. In a nutshell, native land was given to the Presbyterian and then United Church solely for the education and spiritual upkeep of the Ahouset's, in particular the young people. This land was subsequently sold by the church to a private white individual. Simple justice and decency requires that our church rectify our wrong by seeking the return of the said land to the Ahouset's and by publicly admitting our mistake. This issue has been clouded over by our presbytery. Some officials have claimed that the Ahouset's have created roadblocks to meeting or cannot produce appropriate legal documentation to show ownership of the land by the Ahouset's. Sadly, these are precisely the words and accusations that a colonial system has directed against indigenous peoples ever since we took away their land. The very fact that we are waiting for the Ahouset's to prove their case to us or to meet with us on our terms reveals at best an insensitivity on the part of our church to God's call for justice towards those we have wronged. At worst, it indicates a perpetuation of the racist and oppressive relationship that has been our legacy regarding indigenous peoples.
Smallpox was one of the most communicable diseases in human history and was responsible for the deaths of untold millions of indigenous people around the world, even after a vaccine for this disease was discovered in England in the 18th century. In reality, smallpox was a chief weapon in the deliberate germ warfare waged by European powers against native peoples because of its brutal efficiency. Within 10 days of contracting the disease, the victim was dead. Tuberculosis was another weapon in the arsenal of germ warfare used against native people in Canada. A fiercely communicable disease, spread quickly by air and contaminated food, tuberculosis was responsible for many of the deaths of children in Indian residential schools across Canada. According to government officials like Dr. Peter Bryce, residential school staff deliberately and regularly exposed healthy Indian children to tuberculosis by forcing them to sleep and play alongside children dying of the disease, and then denying them aid or treatment. It was this murderous practice that was responsible for an annual death rate in the residential schools of nearly 50%.
This book is used in the university curriculum about residential schools. It has been for almost 10 years. And here's a picture of children with active tuberculosis sores. You see the bandages around their head. And the description says they have active, like open tubercular sores, and they're sitting here alongside healthy children. That was the practice described by Dr. Peter Bryce when he said they were being deliberately exposed to diseases. They weren't being quarantined. When you have tuberculosis, you're quarantined. You don't sit with healthy children. This is proof. This is proof of intent to commit genocide, this picture right here. Yet it's in a mainstream text. People look at it, and still to this day, they say, there's no proof that we're trying to kill native people. Well, the proof is right there in that picture. And that practice, which was happening at every residential school across Canada, and it was documented by their own people,
was superior to all others and had to conquer the world, combined with the vested interest of a merchant class that wanted to conquer the world for its own profit, armed with this religion.
This, Senator Crane, is from the United States government.
Do you understand?
I speak your language.
Good. Senator Crane has come here to offer your people a better way of life.
Better than what?
Better than what you have.
I like what I have.
I understand that. But your people live in the Stone Age. We live at the beginning of a great industrial revolution.
He doesn't understand
Chief, the United States government is offering you a piece of land of your own.
We have our own land.
No, it's not yours. It's the U.S. government's.
Did they buy it?
No.
Did they trade for it?
It's not like that.
Then how can they own it?
He has a point.
If you accept our offer, you won't have to hunt buffalo anymore or roam the prairie. You can depend on your country to take care of you.
You are not my country.
We will give you everything you need if you will just submit to living on a reservation.
We need nothing from you.
Mr. Durant, if we could just...
I'm done, Reverend. Good luck.
I'm a bummer. I don't know. I shouldn't be. I'm a very, lucky guy. I got a lot going for me. I'm healthy. I'm relatively young. I'm white, which thank God for that shit, boy. That is a huge leg up. Are you kidding me? Oh, God, I love being white. I really do. Seriously, if you're not white, you're missing out because this shit is thoroughly good. But let me be clear, by the way. I'm not saying that white people are better. I'm saying that being white is clearly better. Who could even argue? If it was an option, I would re-up every year. Oh, yeah, I'll take white again. Absolutely. I've been enjoying that. I'm going to stick with white. Thank you. I can go to any time. In the past, I don't want to go to the future and find out what happens to white people because we're going to pay hard for this shit. You got to know that. Now, if you're white and you don't admit that it's great, you're an asshole. It is great. And I'm a man. How many advantages could one person have? I'm a white man. You can't even hurt my feelings. What can you really call a white man that really digs deep? Hey, cracker.
Ugh, ruined my day. Boy, shouldn't have called me a cracker. Bringing me back to owning land and people. What a drag.
I mean, everything that we introduce to the world is shitty. Meaning white people. Because I really think that white people are from like another planet. Because when we came to America, it was so nice. It was just Indians. And they weren't even Indians. We called them that by accident. And we still call them that. We ruined everything here. This was the great, it was just coast to coast, just green and brown and beautiful. And all the humans were just walking around with painted faces, just walking. And they'd be like, "Ooh, that looks yummy." And they just eat from the ground and then they'd sleep on the grass.
So let me get this straight. You can come here and you can steal this land from the Native Americans, or you can go to Australia and steal the land from them, or you can go all over the planet and steal land from the indigenous. But now in today's time, you're saying that we need to have some type of reform on immigration where all of these immigrants need to stop invading white lands. Okay, so we're talking about lands that you stole. What if the Native Americans and the Aboriginals had the same policies where they were saying, we don't want immigrants taking over our land? So again, we see the level of hypocrisy that is off the chain where you can do something, but the minute other people want to do what you have done, then you have to have immigration policies.
The United States has a long history in which it abused its relative power over other populations. The United States frequently signed and committed itself to treaties with Native Americans that they repeatedly broke, a practice that has been present in American policy since its inception. In 1874, the U.S. government signed an agreement to purchase the gold-rich Black Hills of South Dakota. This agreement was signed with only a few individual members of the Sioux tribe, a clear violation of the 1869 Sioux Treaty, which required the approval of 3/4 of men of the tribe. Congress responded by passing a law ruling that the agreement overrode the treaty. All in the name of greed and expansion, Native Americans were taken advantage of and systematically deprived of their lands and ability to govern themselves.
The foundation of hypocrisy in this country is mind-blowing. You have people who stole this land from the Native Americans and killed them for it. These same people are supporting the people of Israel who have stolen land from the Palestinians and are killing them for it. And the tripped out thing about all of this is they have the nerve to call them the terrorists. Another interesting fact is that these same people who enslaved Black people and systematically murdered them to this day, they got the nerve to call us thieves, thugs, and animals. You would think that their background is pretty spotless, wouldn't you? Not so. These people have gone all over the planet, killing, raping, murdering, pillaging, and stealing land from indigenous populations.
Brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you that I charge the white man. I charge the white man with being the greatest murderer on earth. I charge the white man with being the greatest kidnapper on earth. There is no place in this world that man can go and say he created peace and harmony. Everywhere he's gone, he's created havoc. Everywhere he's gone, he's created destruction. So I charge him. I charge him with being the greatest kidnapper on this earth. I charge him with being the greatest murderer on this earth. I charge him with being the greatest robber and enslaver on this earth. I charge the white man with being the greatest swine eater on this earth, the greatest junkard on this earth. He can't deny the charges. You can't deny the charges. We're the living proof of those charges. You and I are the proof.
Great Britain, the United States, and other European nations have left a trail of theft and genocide throughout the world. People have been displaced from islands and lands, and billions of dollars in diamonds, gold, copper, rubber, and other fine resources have been taken from their land. 100 years ago, the Herero people of Namibia were nearly exterminated by German colonial soldiers in what has become known as the first genocide of the 20th century. In the colonial period, the Herero men, women, and children of Namibia were rounded up like cattle and put into Germany's first ever concentration camps. 4 years later, 3/4 of the entire Herero nation had perished at the hands of German colonialists. The Nazis used the experiences from the German concentration camps in Namibia, plus their experiences with racial science during the Second World War a few decades later. This was all brought out in the documentary called 100 Years of Silence. The central figure of 100 Years of Silence is a contemporary 23-year-old Herero woman named Georgina. She has a fair complexion and a green tinge to her eyes. Georgina is aware of the fact that her great-grandmother was raped by a German soldier, and now wants to confront the demons of her own genetic past. Between 1885 and 1908, King Leopold II of Belgium turned Congo into its private colony. Under his control, Congo became a gulag labor camp of shocking brutality. Leopold posed as the protector of Africans fleeing Arab slave traders, but in reality, he carved out an empire based on terror to harvest rubber. Families were held as hostages, starving to death if the men failed to produce enough wild rubber. Children's hands were chopped off as punishment for late deliveries. What the Belgians did in the Congo was forgotten for over 50 years. This is a shocking truth about European history, that the Belgian government would rather stay hidden from the rest of the world. Between 1870 and 1900, the Congo was pillaged. It was valuable as a source of rubber. King Leopold created his own colony in the Congo, over which he ruled unchecked. Peter Bates' film, Congo, White King, Red Rubber, Black Death, is a marvelously made reconstruction of those days. It features footage of Congolese villages and explains with actors exactly what happened.
When a series of missionary photographs arrived in England in the late 19th century, they caused outrage. The mutilations had been strategically photographed against white for maximum impact. The children came from the Congo, but the man accused of their suffering was white, European, and royal. For almost 100 years, evidence has lain dormant of one of the greatest mass murders. Millions of Africans died in one man's quest for wealth and glory. Until Adolf Hitler arrived on the scene, the European standard for cruelty was set by a king. Leopold II, King of the Belgians, was the personal owner of 1 million square miles of Central Africa and king sovereign of 20 million Africans. In the 1880s and 90s, the world outside Africa wanted rubber for its new bicycle and car industries, and Leopold's Congo Free State had the world's largest supply of wild rubber. The king had struck gold, black gold. He was determined to get as much rubber to Europe as he could, and as fast as he could.
The rubber in this district has cost hundreds of lives, and the scenes I have witnessed while unable to help the oppressed have been almost enough to make me wish that I were dead.
Over a period of 20 years, Leopold turned the Congo into a vast labor camp 80 times the size of Belgium, in the process making himself into one of the richest men in the world. As the number of deaths grew, so did his profits. The Congolese historian Elikia Ambokolo believes that the truth about Leopold's crimes was deliberately hidden to protect Belgium and Belgian interests in the Congo. This film details the charges against King Leopold and reveals a cover-up of monumental proportions. The signs of the wealth that Leopold amassed are everywhere in Brussels and on an enormous scale. The king built the Cinquantenaire to celebrate the country's 50th anniversary. It's become part of the national identity.
The Cinquantenaire is a very expressive symbol of Belgium and of the proud Belgium. In fact, King Leopold paid for it with his own money. But he didn't say so openly, because this would prove that, first of all, he had a lot of money. People would ask questions where it came from, and then he would have to admit that it came from the Congo. So the Cinquantenaire symbolizes this lie about Belgium and about the royal implication in politics, about the colonial exploitation.
Leopold's Congo was a prison state. Africans had no rights, no justice, and no freedom. They were there to serve a voracious European king. Thousands of miles away, Leopold was content that the end always justified the means, and the end was to make money. The crown domain, 10 times the size of Belgium, was completely sealed off. But a missionary had managed to get in. Morel got hold of his journal and published the atrocities committed by Charles Massard, a Belgian officer known to the Africans as Malu Malu.
The white man, Malu Malu, I feel ashamed of my color every time I think of him, would stand at the door of the store to receive the rubber from the poor, trembling wretches. One man bringing in under the proper amount. The white man flies into a rage, and seizing a rifle from one of the guards, shoots him dead on the spot. The men who had tried to run from the country and had been caught were brought to the station and made to stand one behind the other as an Albini bullet was sent through them. A pity to waste bullets on such wretches.
Almost as an admission of guilt, Leopold ordered the burning of all incriminating Congo State records. Instead of being hanged, Leopold was reinvented as a great humanitarian king, a great civilizer.
In the 17th century, South Africa was colonized by the English and Dutch. English domination of the Dutch descendants, known as Boers or Afrikaners, resulted in the Dutch establishing the new colonies of the Orange Free State and Transvaal. The discovery of diamonds in these lands around 1900 resulted in an English invasion, which sparked the Boer War. Following independence from England, an uneasy power sharing between the two groups held sway until the 1940s, when the Afrikaner National Party was able to gain a strong majority. Strategists in the National Party invented apartheid as a means to cement their control over the economic and social system. Initially, aim of the apartheid was to maintain white domination while extending racial separation. Starting in the 60s, a plan of grand apartheid was executed, emphasizing territorial separation and police repression. After the National Party gained power in South Africa in 1948, its all-white government immediately began enforcing existing policies of racial segregation under a system of legislation that it called apartheid. Under apartheid, non-white South Africans, a majority of the population, would be forced to live in separate areas from whites and use separate public facilities, and contact between the two groups would be limited. Despite strong and consistent opposition to apartheid within and outside of South Africa, its laws remained in effect for the better part of 50 years. In 1991, the government of President F.W. de Klerk began to repeal most of the legislation that provided the basis for apartheid. South African mines are world leaders in the production of diamonds and gold, as well as strategic metals such as platinum, and this is what the Europeans were after. Again, foreign lands were robbed of its resources, and the thieves go free. In the 1960s, the American government wanted the Chagos Islands in the Indian Ocean, in their words, swept and sanitized. An entire population was declared expendable. All of them were to be deported. The people of the Chagos Islands were secretly and brutally expelled from their homeland by British governments in the late 1960s and early 1970s to make way for an American military base. This island was known as Fantasy Island, and this is where America have a huge military base that had a specific role in the War on Terror and Iraq. The Chagos Islands was once home to 2,000 Creoles, British citizens and loyal subjects who had lived there for at least 200 years, but whom in 1961 were mysteriously turned into a floating people or British colony, BIOT, and annexed from their homeland by the British government by the force of a special decree called the Order of Council, which conveniently bypasses Parliament and is a bill only agreed to by the monarch in a private ceremony. The tragedy, which falls within the remit of the International Criminal Court as a crime against humanity, is told by islanders who were dumped in the slums of Mauritius and by British officials who left behind a damning trail of Foreign Office documents. From Fantasy Island to the slums. This information was all brought out in the documentary Stealing a Nation by John Pilger. In 1969, CRA, an Australian subsidiary of the British mining giant Rio Tinto Zinc, forcibly established a copper mine on Bougainville. From the beginning, the island's people resisted the construction of the mine. The building of the mine saw 800 villagers landless and another 1,400 without fishing rights as land was seized and rainforest cleared. The subsistence life of gardening and fishing was destroyed. 220 hectares of rainforest was poisoned, felled, burned, and bulldozed. After 20 years, the mine had grown to a huge crater, half a kilometer deep and nearly 7 kilometers in circumference, creating over 1 billion tons of waste. In 1988, after 2 decades of ignored protests, petitions, and compensation claims, Bougainvillians had had enough. A handful of islanders stole company explosives, destroying electricity pylons, buildings, and machinery. By using guerrilla tactics, they succeeded in closing the mine. Until the war broke out in 1988, the mine accounted for around 45% of all Papua New Guinea's total export earnings. Papua New Guinea, PNG, with the assistance of Australia, responded by sending in the military. Following this, Bougainville declared itself independent from the PNG, and the Bougainvillians formed the Bougainville Revolutionary Army, BRA, to defend their land and their environment from further exploitation. There were over 10,000 killed in Australia's secret war. The Australian government claims that it does not support PNG's war on the people of Bougainville, but Australia has been funding, arming, and directing the PNG military since the beginning. Australia provides Papua New Guinea with $32 million in military aid, plus much more in untied aid. This information was all brought out in the documentary The Coconut Revolution. Again, we can clearly see how the United States, Great Britain, and other European nations have pillaged, raped, robbed, killed, and destroyed countries, from Iraq to Libya, the Congo to South Africa, indigenous lands of Australia to the Indian Ocean, all in the name of greed.
I wonder if you'd believe this as a solution to the Aboriginal problem. Herd the worst of the Aborigines into one area and put a chemical in their water that sent them sterile. In time, there'd be none of them left. Well, that solution has been put forward by none other than one of the Premier's closest friends, West Australian mining magnate, Lang Hancock.
Those that have been assimilated into, earning good living or earning wages amongst the civilised areas, that have been accepted into society, and they have accepted society and can handle society, I'd leave them well alone. The ones that are no good to themselves, who can't accept things, the half-caste, and this is where most of the trouble comes, I would dope the water up so that they were sterile and would breed themselves out in future, and that would solve the problem.
Now, I wouldn't mind for it if it was just the black, the true Aboriginal, but there are so many hybrids, and they're nearly white, and this is where it hurts me. Now, I wouldn't mind for it if it was just the black, the true Aboriginal, but there are so many hybrids, and they're nearly white, and this is where it hurts me. Now, I wouldn't mind, Philip, if it was just the black, the true Aboriginal, but there are so many hybrids, and they're nearly white, and this is where it hurts me.
White men think that land, no matter how sacred it is to us, can be destroyed for money. The greatest threat to the survival of our culture comes from the multinational mining companies. These companies have discovered wealth and profits under the last areas of Australia which we hold.
The word jihad is mentioned in the Quran about 41 times. The words mercy, peace and compassion are mentioned about 355 times. Yes, come in. Come on in, Riaz. Sit down, please.
Contrary to popular belief in most Western cultures, Islam is a religion that preaches peace and tolerance. Yes, Patricia.
If Islam truly is a religion that preaches peace, then how come the world's most troubled spots, you know, the West Bank, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, they're all plagued with Islamic terrorism?
Well, that depends on your definition of terrorism. Some might argue that the U.S. invasions of countries like Iraq and Afghanistan are also acts of terrorism.
No, those were acts of war to get rid of despotic regimes.
Or a means of getting at a country's oil.
Conspiracy theories.
Well,
may I?
Yes, please. Go ahead, Reza.
Mr. Khan is right. I mean, if we're talking about terrorists, the world's biggest terrorists are the white superpowers.
Come on now.
No, really. Stop and think about it.
Explain 9/11.
Okay. Do you know how many people died in the Twin Towers strike?
Around 3,000.
And do you have any idea how many people died in the bombing of Afghanistan? Take a wild guess. More than 15,000 people died. And that's just conservative figures. About 50,000 tons of explosives were dropped on innocent civilians. Men, women, children.
Yeah, but that was because of the Taliban.
Now that you brought it up, did you know that the Taliban was a creation of the CIA? To fight the Russians.
Whatever. They were still harboring terrorists.
Yeah, right. Terrorists that were never found. Just like the weapons of mass destruction that were never found in Iraq. Do you want to get into the debt toll in Iraq? 500,000 civilians and counting. And what do Britain and America say when they don't find these weapons? It's simple. They just say sorry. And still refuse to relinquish control of these countries.
What are you trying to say?
What I'm trying to say is that just because you're American, wear a fancy suit, and call yourself the president, doesn't make you any less of a terrorist. I'm saying that if you don't stop meddling in other people's countries, you will face a backlash.
If Muslims like you feel that way, then why don't you get out of our country?
We will. As soon as you promise to leave ours.
American interrupted an anti-illegal immigration protest in Arizona. Let's hear what he had to say.
Fight none of you.
Exactly.
Get on. Get on with your bogus arguments. Get on with your bogus arguments. We're the only legal ones here.
We have Native Americans here.
Yeah. We should have put that sign up when you son of a bitches came. Yeah, that's right. It represents blood. That represents blood spilled by Native Americans protecting this land from the invaders. Yeah, that's right. That's right. You don't want to hear the goddamn truth, do you? Get on, bitch. You don't want to hear the truth. That's what that flag stands for. All the Native Americans you killed to plant your houses here.
You're
that's
right.
The truth. That's the truth. That's the truth.
Get on, bitch.
Now, it is indisputable what he's saying. Now, it makes people uncomfortable, right? And we hope that the United States has gotten beyond, obviously, some of the atrocities that were committed. Obviously, we still have a lot to work on. But you can't dispute what he's saying. We did form the country by completely running over the Native Americans.
Yeah, this country was founded on illegal immigration.
Yeah, and quite literally, the people that came over on the Mayflower were undocumented immigrants.
Right.
They didn't have any papers. Okay, they didn't ask the permission of the Native Americans to land here. And then they certainly didn't ask the permission of the Native Americans when they started butchering them and then moving them onto reservations and then violating those agreements and moving them again and having them die on the road and then having them die in the reservations and having them die on the fields that they used to hunt in and live in, etc. Again, it was a long time ago, hundreds of years ago. You didn't do it, right? You didn't build that, right? But when he says, hey, listen, you guys were undocumented immigrants, so don't go complaining about undocumented immigrants now, when the entire country was literally built on that, well, that's tough to argue with.
Over time, we have literally changed the face of the earth. So much so that the harm we've done seems irreversible. We're told that the Earth is dying and we must save it. It's a heroic notion, but it hasn't been very effective in changing our behavior so far.
I need to get the Earth's population down to about 500,000 people. I'll start by poisoning the food with GMOs, high fructose corn syrup, MSG, and aspartame. And I'll also inject the livestock with hormones and steroids and raise it inhumanely. Yes, it will be full of E. coli and salmonella poisoning and other toxins. but wait, then I will treat the water with fluoride and the air with chemtrails. I can also pollute the earth with harmful plastics, crude oil, and other poisonous substances. Next, I will pollute everything else with radiation from my nuclear plant.
Where creative chemistry works wonders for you.
The wonders boasted about in this commercial made Monsanto one of the most controversial companies in the industrial era. Agent Orange, aspartame, bovine growth hormone, PCBs. These chemically created oils used worldwide as coolants and lubricants in electrical equipment were the jewels in Monsanto's crown for over 50 years. They were called Arachlor in the United States, Pyrrolin in France, and Clofen in Germany, until they were banned in the early 1980s. Monsanto PCB. A Washington Post article from 2002. Monsanto hid decades of pollution. It happened in Anniston, Alabama.
Terry was my baby brother. He died in 1971. From a cancer of the brains, or a tumor of the brains, cancer of the lungs, and hers of the heart. He was 16. In the last 3 years, I have lost more friends. They died from illnesses, cancer, sugar diabetes, hepatitis, all these different ailments that comes with PCBs, and they have been related to PCB. This is Monsanto Road. This is all just a black area, minorities that live in this area. But every one of these homes was like contaminated. They just cleaned that yard up over there to the right about 6 months ago. These was all homes. These people lived here and they had to move. The houses was torn down. My brother fell dead right around the house. This is the house I was raised in. See this grass right here, they buried PCBs over here. Monsanto got permission to bury PCBs in Anniston. And this is Snow Creek right here where they put the cement in here. It comes from the plant discharging to PCBs all the way down through here. And it was poisoning, they never told anybody. But they told the state. The state didn't tell us.
PCB Monsanto knew, but what exactly did they know? An environmental organization in Washington, D.C., headed by Ken Cook, has put internal Monsanto files online. Most of them are classified confidential. FYI and destroy. In 1937, exposure to PCBs provokes systemic toxic effects and acne-form skin eruption. In 1961, two workers developed hepatitis symptoms after a pipe broke in a factory using PCBs. In 1966, Monsanto scientists placed fish in Snow Creek's water. All were dead in 3.5 minutes. Pollution, a letter addressed to sales executives in 1970.
This is the one that really tells you the story. They're saying, we can't afford to lose $1 of business. Their neighbors in Anniston were not told about the poisoning that they were inflicting upon them because they didn't want to lose $1. It was only when lawyers went to court on behalf of people in Anniston and forced the company through the legal system to disclose these internal secret documents that we knew what they knew. They knew the truth from the very beginning. They lied about it, they hid the truth from their neighbors, they hid the truth in many cases from the government authorities. And when they did share information with government authorities that should have been acted upon, the government authorities, instead of siding with the people who were being poisoned, sided with the company. They sided with Monsanto. It was outrageous, absolutely unforgivable.
These are all your medicines?
Yeah.
Well, no, they ain't all of them. I got some more here.
How much you have in you?
63.8 in the blood.
In the blood. If they took a fatty biopsy of him now, he probably would top the scales of about 3,000 or 4,000 parts per billion or more.
And which is the level acceptable? I mean,
acceptable is 2 parts per billion. That's the standard all around the world. But these people, we have more in our blood and in our body than actually anywhere else in the world.
Uh-huh. It's usual here to speak about his PCB level.
We all talks about it because it became a household word now. Kids used to run up to me, Mr. Baker, I got tested. I had 3 part per billion in my blood. How long do you think I got?
Oh, it's all over the place. It goes down under here. See where it's in my belly button? But it goes down across and down across my rear end. And it's hot. If you put your hand on it, you can feel, see how, that's how they tell you how you got exposure. They hold it like that and you see your fingerprints. The longer your fingerprints stay in there, the more exposure. This has been on me for 3 years.
He went to bed one night and I was still up and he came down and was going all around. I said, what the heck's the matter with you? Well, his tongue was so swollen he couldn't even talk. We had to get a spoon put in there so he could breathe till we got him to the hospital.
Chemicals and radiation poison. See the big patch of it on my belly and it just blows you up. Range Resources use 880 chemicals. 650 of them is cancer-causing, and a third of them is neurological. Then plus on top of all that stuff getting in your body, you'll get the silica sand, which flies over your head of these well pads, and it'll go into your lungs. While it goes in, it doesn't come out, and it's treated sand.
About, what, maybe 2 months ago?
Yeah, over 2 months.
I had video of that, too. All the fish came up, hundreds of them dead.
Every species.
And look what it's next to, a leaking gas well. And meanwhile, DEP comes here, and Fish and Boat Commission, they say there's no connection. No connection to gastrin. Common sense.
It's a community page, so anybody can get on. If you're over in Australia, and you have something going on in Australia, you click up on this page, send what's going on in Australia. People around the world, this ain't just the United States. This is a global thing.
Authorities in northern Italy say more than 1,000 turtle doves have dropped dead over the past 5 days. It's the latest in a series of unexplained sudden death incidents affecting creatures in the sky and underwater. The events have sparked a media frenzy, with doomsday speculators saying it hails the end of the world. But is there really something fishy going on, or is it being overhyped? Artiska Junazarva reports.
Sing a song of suspense, one where the end is nigh, as thousands of blackbirds fell out of the sky. And when the birds were found, the news began to sing, The End of Days conspiracy does have a catchy ring. At first, it was just Arkansas grabbing the world's attention. Then, Louisiana followed suit, and Europe ruffled some feathers with mysterious avian deaths in Sweden. Experts attempted to calm the public by suggesting the birds got scared of fireworks or flew into trees and cars because of bad weather.
All we know is that fireworks or weather could not cause 5,000 blackbirds to have liquefied insides. That's what the Fish and Wildlife veterinarian said. They've never seen anything like it. Now we're seeing the same pulverization of the insides of blackbirds. They are dead when they hit the ground. They are dying in the night while they're roosting in trees.
But then 100,000 dead fish turned up on U.S. shores, and that seemed to have opened the floodgates.
I think the media is, by and large, not blowing it out of proportion. They're actually underestimating how serious it is. So I believe we have multiple causes, but basically they all mean that the entire planet now is an uproar, that we have a toxic release of gases, the changes in the oceanic currents that now means the entire world current system is now disrupted.
For those not very impressed with a scientific explanation, there's always the religious one. Fanatical bloggers have once again started flooding the World Wide Web with End of Days posts. And the international media, starved for news during the slow post-Christmas month of January, is having a field day.
And you are asked to call sooner rather than later.
Now, we did contact state agricultural officials so far.
You could not even get down the road without running over hundreds. It was that bad.
With more and more mysterious deaths around the world, fish in Brazil, Australia, and New Zealand, crabs in the UK, the frenzy is growing and the headlines scream aquacalypse.
These fishy stories look set to continue stealing the media spotlight, at least until scientists have had a chance to examine the dead animals, or, you know, the world comes to an end, whichever, of course, happens first. Katrin Azarva, RT, Moscow.
We'll be right back. Hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel. For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land. By swearing, and lying, and killing, and stealing, and committing adultery, they break out, and blood toucheth blood. Therefore shall the land mourn, and everyone that dwelleth therein shall languish with the beasts of the field, and with the fowls of heaven. Yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. And the second angel poured out his vial upon the sea, and it became as the blood of a dead man, and every living soul died in the sea. And the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers, and fountains of waters, and they became blood. And I heard the angel of the waters say, Thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and wast and shalt be, because thou hast judged thus. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy.
History of the United States of America. Hi, boys and girls, ready to get started? Once upon a time, there were these people in Europe called pilgrims, and they were afraid of being persecuted. So they all got in a boat and sailed to the New World where they wouldn't have to be scared ever again.
Oh, I'm so relaxed.
Ooh, I feel so much safer.
But as soon as they arrived, they were greeted by savages, and they got scared all over again. So they killed them all. Now, you'd think wiping out a race of people would calm them down, but no. Instead, they started getting frightened of each other.
Witch!
Witch!
So they burned witches. In 1775, they started killing the British so they could be free. And it worked. But they still didn't feel safe. So they passed a Second Amendment which said every white man could keep his gun.
I loves my gun. Loves my gun.
Which brings us to the genius idea of slavery. You see, boys and girls, the white people back then were also afraid of doing any work. So they went to Africa, kidnapped thousands of black people, brought them back to America, and forced them to work very hard for no money. And I don't mean no money like,
I work at Walmart and make no money.
I mean $0, nothing, not a zip. Doing it that way made the USA the richest country in the world. So did having all that money and free help calm the white people down? No way. They got even more afraid. That's because after 200 years of slavery, the black people now outnumbered the white people in many parts of the South. Well, you can pretty much guess what came next. The slaves started rebelling. There were uprisings. An old master's head got chopped off. And when white people heard of this, they were freaking out and going, I wanna live! Don't kill me, big black man! Well, just in the nick of time came Samuel Colt, who, in 1836, invented the first weapon ever that could be fired over and over without having to reload. And all the southern whites were like, yee-haw! But it was too late. The North soon won the Civil War and the slaves were freed. Yep, they were free now to go chop all the old master's heads off. And everybody was like, oh no, we're gonna die. But the freed slaves took no revenge. They just wanted to live in peace. But you couldn't convince the white people of this. So they formed the Ku Klux Klan. And in 1871, the same year the Klan became an illegal terrorist organization, another group was founded, the National Rifle Association. Soon politicians passed one of the first gun laws, making it illegal for any black person to own one. It was a great year for America, the KKK and the NRA. Of course, they had nothing to do with each other, and this was just a coincidence. One group legally promoted responsible gun ownership, and the other group shot and lynched black people. And that's the way it was all the way to 1955, when a black woman broke the law by refusing to move to the back of the bus. White people just couldn't believe it.
Huh? Well, I won't say no.
What's going on? Man, all hell broke loose. Black people everywhere started demanding their rights, and white people had a major freaky field meltdown. And they were all like, run away! Run away! And they did. They all ran fleeing to the suburbs where it was all white and safe and clean. And they went out and bought a quarter of a billion guns and put locks on the doors, alarms in the houses, and gates around the neighborhoods. And finally, they were all safe and secure and snug as a bug. And everyone lived happily ever after.
What if black governments invaded white countries and stole all of their resources after presenting the inhabitants with Bibles and death? What if black groups and mobs kidnapped and took millions of white people into slavery and killed millions of them by throwing them overboard to sharks? What if the surviving white people were enslaved for hundreds of years and were subsequently raped, sodomized, hung, whipped, had their children taken away and sent far away and forced to eat pig slop? What if white babies were snatched away while their mothers worked in the fields and used by black men as bait to hunt and catch alligators? What if white women were taken from their husbands and children in the middle of the night by her black slave master and was forced to sleep with him and carry his child in her womb for 9 months and her husband could do nothing but stand helplessly by or be killed? What if white men had to face the black man who raped his wife and daughters and told this white man that his wife better pretend like she enjoyed it or she would be beaten within an inch of her life? What if white women were forced to breastfeed the children of black women while her own children cried in the distance with no one to hold and feed them? What if white men had to bow down to a black man and beg them not to sell their families to other black slave masters who lived thousands of miles away, knowing that he would never see them again? What if white women were forced to work in the fields in the hot sun all day long just after giving birth to a baby and not allowing her to rest or heal or even being allowed to nurture her newborn child? What if a pregnant white woman was hung upside down from a tree by an angry black mob and had her belly cut open with a knife so that her infant's body would hit the ground and she bled and cried while watching an angry black man crush her baby's head with his boots and saw this man start to bellow with laughter as she grieved this violent murder of her child and then took her last breath before she too died from the brutal capturing? What if white men, women, and children were stopped if seen walking on the roads and asked, "Show me your papers, wiggers"? What if white families were accosted while sleeping in their beds in the middle of the night by angry black mobs on horses and hoods with fire torches demanding that they leave town or be burned alive? What if white families were systematically terrorized on a daily basis by black mobs burning crosses in their front yards with the full support of all black police departments? What if white churches were burned to the ground by hateful, angry black men with no regard to the human life in the killing of four little white girls? What if angry, hateful black men hunted whole white families and hung them all from trees, including their white children? What if little white girls were forced to have sex with hateful, angry adult black males before their little bodies could even bear such brutal treatment? What if black women screamed rape if a white man simply looked at her and caused black men to go on a rampage and kill this white man in an angry mob style? What if black women forced white women to clean, cook, wash, scrub, dig, dust, and slave all day with no breaks to take care of her little white children and would whip her if she dared question any of her duties as a white slave? What if black women smacked the hell out of a white woman for merely asking for a break to go and breastfeed her white infant who has been crying for hours unattended? What if black horse riders would tie a white man's legs each to one horse and force the horses to run in different directions, thus ripping his body into two pieces and rolled away laughing and mocking at his dismembered dead corpse? What if black angry mobs went into white neighborhoods and killed hundreds of white people while burning their houses, businesses, churches, hospitals, and banks to the ground, totally unprovoked? What if black countries stole all of the resources from white countries, causing them to live impoverished lives while planting diseases in their communities through tainted food, aid, and medications and vaccines laced with deadly diseases and viruses? What if white children were buried in the sand with only their heads sticking out and deranged black men came with full force kicking this white child's head so hard that it separated from their little bodies? What if white children were not taught their true history in schools taught by black teachers who supported the black supremacist agenda of keeping white people down? What if black news media, movies, advertisements, and publications always portrayed whites as lowlife scum that had no real moral values, thus lowering the self-esteem of white children? What if black people changed what really took place in history to hide things from white people because they knew they could better control white people with false made up history, and they knew that because they as black people controlled the printing of all materials for centuries, it would make it easier to deceive white people about their true history.
African American Wrongful Convictions Throughout History by Edwin Grimsley. Racially disparate treatment has permeated the United States criminal justice system throughout history. During the Jim Crow era, blacks were legally barred from voter rolls in several southern states and were therefore barred from serving on juries. In this era of racial strife, the police, prosecution, defense attorneys, judges, and jurors were almost always white. Cross-racial misidentifications, forced confessions, all-white juries, and blatant racism led to the wrongful convictions of countless innocent black people. Between the 1870s and 1960s, a significant number of black defendant, white victim allegations never made it to trial. The Tuskegee Institute archive estimates approximately 3,500 lynching deaths of blacks. How many of the lynched were actually innocent will forever be a mystery. A quarter century later, the Scottsboro Boys convictions raised public awareness about racial injustice and galvanized the civil rights movement. In 1931, a fight occurred between black and white boys on a freight train traveling through the town of Scottsboro, Alabama. The police rounded up all black boys riding on the train and ultimately arrested 9 black boys, ranging in ages from 12 to 19 years old. 2 white girls then came forward, alleging that they were gang raped on the train. All 9 defendants claimed innocence. After 4 separate one-day trials with all-white juries, 8 of the 9 were convicted and sentenced to death. Their appeals would last over 20 years. On retrial, one of the rape victims testified that the rape was fabricated, yet all-white juries again returned guilty verdicts. In the end, after facing multiple retrials, all of the Scottsboro boys had their convictions dropped or were sentenced to lesser charges. The Alabama legislature recently introduced a bill to posthumously exonerate the 9 Scottsboro boys. This case, and many others, showcase decades of racial bias in the criminal justice system. Because media reports and public outrage expose only the most prominent wrongful convictions, we will never know how many innocent African Americans were falsely convicted or executed. Andre Davis spent over 31 years in prison for a rape and murder he did not commit. James Hill, who served over 17 years in prison in Indiana for rape after the police concealed evidence pointing to another suspect, and DNA testing excludes him as the rapist. Terrell Swift of the Englewood Four was falsely imprisoned based on a false confession before being exonerated by DNA evidence. Darrell Cannon, who served 19 years after he was linked to a quadruple murder by Burgess detectives who used electric shock, bagging, suffocation, and other brutality at the hands of police. Ronald Kitchen, who served 21 years behind bars, 13 on death row, after Burgess detectives tortured him for 39 hours and eventually coerced a statement in which he confessed to 5 murders. Jerry Miller, who served over 20 years in prison for a rape and kidnapping before DNA testing established his innocence. Leroy Orange, who was wrongly convicted of 4 murders based on a coerced confession. Ronald Jones, who served 14 years in prison, 8 of them on death row, before he was absolved by DNA evidence and pardoned based on innocence. This is only a few of thousands of black men that have been wrongfully convicted of crimes. Police have lied, planted evidence, tortured and forced African Americans to confess of crimes they didn't commit. Being wrongfully convicted is bad in itself, but when you add police brutality and murder by excessive force, you have the makings of a police state. Time and time again, we're seeing new cases of police brutality and the murder of unarmed civilians.
What if white people were killed if they were caught reading and blacks even made it illegal for whites to learn how to read? What if black males were going around hanging white males from trees for fun and black cops refused to take the statements from the white males who escaped the hangings and even threatened the white male to leave town and don't pursue this any further or be handled by them? What if black leaders used their power and authority to force drugs into white neighborhoods and destroy the whole white family structure through a system of corruption? What if black teachers verbally abused and intentionally miseducated white children in an effort to keep them down and keep them in their place? What if a white leader tried to rise up to unite his people for justice and the black leaders of the nation ordered a hit on him and had him assassinated at the Lorraine Motel in Memphis, Tennessee? What if a 14-year-old white teenage boy whistled at a black woman and two angry black men came to his family's house in the middle of the night, threatened the family's life if they didn't turn him over, and then these two black men took this 14-year-old white teenager somewhere and tortured him beyond recognition before killing him and tossing his battered, tortured body like trash? What if the black officials that heard of this crime against this white teenager decided that the black man who committed this heinous crime did nothing wrong and let them walk free for decades? What if white men were interrogated for hours and physically abused by black police officers while in custody and sometimes even killed while in custody? What if a 13-year-old white boy who looked like a 10-year-old was falsely accused of killing two little black girls and forced by black cops to sign a confession to hide the fact that a black adult male really committed this crime, but still pursued a case against this young white boy that resulted in him being executed in an electric chair with straps that were too big to even secure his little frail white body by black prison officials, while a mob of angry black people watched and cheered as this young white child was fried in his seat and died with no family present because the black mobs ran them out of town with violent threats? What if a white teenager was walking down the street and was approached by a black neighborhood watch captain who was told not to follow this white teenager, but this black captain did anyway and ended up killing this white teen and claiming self-defense and was subsequently let go by black police officers who accepted his claim of self-defense? What if a white teenager was shot and killed by a black civilian for simply playing his music too loud? What if a black woman ran down a 13-year-old white child with her car by driving up on the sidewalk intentionally, hitting this white child and almost killing him for riding his go-kart too fast on the sidewalk? What if a black man was riding down the street and intentionally struck a white construction worker because he felt that all whites should be exterminated from the earth?
a man claiming he's Jesus plows his car into a PG&E worker, pinning him against his truck because the worker was black. The man's passenger, who had a hatchet, and innocent bystanders come to the rescue.
Comes driving down this way. He's like, you know what? I come to realize I'm Jesus Christ and I can do anything I want to. And watch this. Bam! And he smashed into this guy right there, pinned him in between that truck.
Homeless hitchhiker Kai was in the passenger seat of the Oldsmobile when this all went down.
He just kept saying he was Jesus Christ and he's going to save all of us and that, but we have to get... He used the N-word, meaning the black people, in that. He said we need to get them off the earth.
The African-American PG&E worker was rushed to the hospital and underwent surgery for non-life-threatening injuries.
What if black bankers denied white citizens of the chance to own their own home by either denying them loans or giving them unaffordable high interest rates? What if black police officers constantly harassed and pulled over white males for simple infractions and systematically beat or tased them for looking suspicious? What if black police officers were acquitted time and time again for killing innocent, unarmed white teenage boys who did nothing but walk while white?
In the past decade alone, January 24, 2004, Timothy Stansberry, Brooklyn, New York, unarmed. November 25, 2006, Sean Bell, Queens, New York, unarmed. January 1, 2009, Oscar Grant, Oakland, California, unarmed. January 29, 2010, Aaron Campbell, Portland, Oregon, unarmed. July 18, 2011, Alonzo Ashley, Denver, Colorado, unarmed. March 7, 2012, Wendell Allen, New Orleans, Louisiana, unarmed. September 14, 2013, Jonathan Farrell, Charlotte, North Carolina, unarmed. July 17, 2014, Eric Garner, Staten Island, New York, unarmed. August 9, 2014, Michael Brown, Ferguson, Missouri, unarmed. In the past decade alone, these men and hundreds of others have lost their lives to police. Local police report to the FBI killing at least 400 people a year. From 2006 to 2012, a white police officer killed a black person at least twice a week in this country. Which brings us back to Ferguson, Missouri. According to a report in the Daily Beast, in 2009, police officers charged a man for property damage because he bled on their uniforms while they arrested him and allegedly beat him bloody. Ferguson, Missouri, where it took 6 days to release the name of an officer who shot an unarmed teenager to death. Ferguson is just outside St. Louis, Missouri. The place where, as historian Blair Kelly reminded us this week in The Root, Dred Scott sued for his freedom on the grounds that he and his wife had for many years lived in a free state. His case eventually went to the Supreme Court, and in 1857, Chief Justice Roger Taney declared that Scott had no right to sue because, as a black man, he was never intended to be an American. Speaking on the clause in the Declaration of Independence, that all men are created equal, Taney wrote, quote, "It is too clear for dispute that the enslaved African race were not intended to be included and formed no part of the people who framed and adopted this declaration." And he went on to say that black men had no rights which the white man was bound to respect. No rights which the white man was bound to respect. No rights which the white man was bound to respect. No rights which the white man was bound to respect.
Good evening, Jim. The use of undercover informants is a common police technique used to bring charges against suspects not inclined to deal directly with cops. But often, the undercover agent is a shady character facing his own charges. That makes him motivated to give police what they want, whether the suspect has done something wrong or not.
Donald Andrews Jr. operates a so-called smoke shop on Mohawk Avenue in Scotia. It sells incense and other smoking paraphernalia, legal stuff, but material that might also be repurposed for other illicit activities. Scotia and Schenectady County police became suspicious and targeted Andrews' shop, sending an undercover informant in twice in March. The second time, Andrew's attorney, Kevin Liebrand, does play-by-play that appears to show the informant planting, then photographing crack cocaine that led to Andrew's arrest.
Donald turns, he comes in, places the crack on the counter, crack which under federal sentencing guidelines would get him 4 years in jail, under New York state law would get him 2 to 7 years in jail.
There are 7 cameras in plain view in Andrew's small store. Here's a second clear angle.
He walks in, places the crack cocaine on the counter.
Members of the Schenectady chapter of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference viewed the apparent framing of an African-American businessman and were outraged.
It was a setup, and I believe that he was racially profiled and targeted, and it would be easy for them to say that he was selling drugs because he was black.
Now, neither the Schenectady County Sheriff nor the Scotia Village Police Chief were available to be interviewed about the apparent planting of evidence. By phone, the sheriff acknowledged proper procedures were not followed, but denied his investigators purposely framed the suspect. The sheriff blamed the informant, who has taken flight. Andrews was arrested but released when he was able to get police to look at the multiple camera angles. He's taken the first step at filing a lawsuit and was not made available today by his attorney. Bill Lambden, News Channel 13.
It's this traffic stop from 3 weeks ago that's landed a former Trooper of the Year behind bars. The graphic video shows just what happened. Prosecutors say the trooper stopped a man at the Circle K on Broad River Road for a seatbelt violation. It's what happened next that now has the trooper charged with a felony.
Has he your license, please?
Get on the ground!
Just hours ago, that same video was shown in bond court as a judge granted a $75,000 cash bond to the former trooper. The South Carolina Highway Patrol fired Trooper Sean Grubert last Friday and said, for reasons only Grubert can articulate, he fired on the unarmed victim, 35-year-old LeVar Jones, who was struck in the hip.
Are you hit?
I think so. I can't feel my leg. I don't know what happened. I just grabbed my leg.
Brakes on A66. I need a 1052.
Why did you shoot me?
Well, you dove head first back into your car.
The police officer who shot the boy has been taken off the streets tonight with full pay, and the boy he shot is now out of surgery here but continues to cling to life. There was outrage and anguish tonight after police shot a 12-year-old boy over a BB gun.
They shot him! A little black boy!
Officers arrived here at the Cadell Rec Center this afternoon on a call of a man on the premises with a gun.
In the park behind us here.
Police say they told the boy to show his hands, but instead he lifted up his shirt and police say he displayed this, a BB gun that looks just like a real gun.
The young man had the weapon in his waistband. He pulled the weapon out. One of our officers fired 2 shots. Striking the young man.
The 12-year-old boy?
Yes.
Apparently the boy did not point the gun at officers. Did he threaten the officers?
No.
He didn't threaten officers at all?
There was no verbal or no confrontation.
The officer fired 2 shots, hitting the boy at least once in the stomach. Neighbors say the officer was too quick to shoot and are disgusted.
Always killing a black kid, right?
A 49-year-old man who his family says suffered from serious mental health issues. Paul, seen in the middle of your screen, police say, had just had a run-in with a convenience store clerk. He was in a standoff with police and holding some sort of knife. A female officer is heard shouting. If you listen carefully, Paul is then heard continuing to yell at police. Paul seems agitated, but not intimidated by a police dog. Heard on the tape, a witness describes what he sees.
In the karate stands, about to go ham on him.
Then, as Hall appears to take a few steps, everything comes to a head. Local media report 46 shots were fired. CNN counted the sounds of at least 30 shots on the videotape.
Watch as the man in the red shirt and shorts walks with his hands up to his car. He gets in, then emerges with this.
Gun!
Police officers immediately shout out a warning that he's armed, then take cover. Dave Street saw it as it happened.
He got out of his car, and he's waving his gun around, pointing all around everywhere, and he pointed at the helicopter, okay? So...
Finally, he got up from a seated position and walked to the shade of a nearby tree. Police slowly moved in and took him into custody, later telling reporters they'd been summoned to De Anza Cove by a caller who said the man had a weapon.
The actual shooting you'll see, as Jenk said, how fast it happens.
Unbelievable. Immediate danger to anyone else. There's nobody there. It's not like he's a hostage and they have to shoot him right away. They don't have to pull up right against him and shoot him.
On the grass. Maybe if he'd gone to the street, you wouldn't have been as much risk.
Look, there's two cops, two grown men with real guns and a cop car. They can't stop the car 50 feet away and say, drop your weapon. And the kid will drop the weapon or he'll say, it's not a real weapon.
Now imagine the outroar if that 12-year-old child had been a 45-year-old militia member who was parading around that playground with a rifle in his shoulder. They would say he's exercising his rights.
No, that's such a great point. Because if it was a real weapon held by a 45-year-old white right-winger, people would be livid. How dare you shoot a guy exercising his Second Amendment rights to just carry around his weapon, right? Yeah. It's a fake gun. It's a 12-year-old. And of course, what's everybody doing there? Defending the cops, right?
And I think racism has moved to the place in America where if you don't see context, that makes you a racist.
Right. Well, one of these things is not like the other. As I look at this panel. But you have to realize that, yes, the involvement of violence in black folks comes from that long history that the president was talking about, that we have to remember that we learned from some of the best. They had some white boys came over here that did the first beheadings in Point Coupee, Louisiana, where I'm from. Slave insurrection, that was the way you dealt with it. Tuskegee syphilis incident. We're going to see how black men die if they have syphilis, but we pretend we treat them with penicillin, and we're just going to watch the pathology of how they die. Now, that wasn't back 200 years ago. That was 1930 to 1974. We're talking about giving these wonderful blankets to Native Americans infected with smallpox as they walked on that trail of tears just to see how they die and to eliminate their population so we can take all of that land. So the violence that is in America has come from a very learned position that was brought here by some Caucasian folks. All right? So now...
What if black companies refused to hire white people using an unfair hiring practice that made it seem as though the white applicants were unqualified when really they were just as qualified as the black applicants? What if an 82-year-old elderly white woman was singing and rattling beads on a commuter train and a black security officer dragged her off the train, causing injury to her due to him making her fall because he claimed she was disturbing the peace and impeding others from hearing the train's announcements? What if black people were always excusing the crimes committed by blacks against white people by claiming the criminal had a hard life as a child because he was a genius who just snapped while at the same time wanting capital punishment or the death penalty for a white person who committed the same crime as the black person they made excuses for? What if two black police officers responded to a life alert call of an elderly white man and the elderly white man told them he was okay? It is a false alarm, but the black officers force their way in anyway and attacks the elderly white man and kills him in his own apartment, and local black police officials claim that it was a justified killing. What if a 7-year-old innocent little white girl was shot in the neck by a black police officer while she was taking a nap on the couch in her living room because the police officer did not heed warnings from people in the neighborhood that there were children inside the house before they raided it?
More cops came rushing the house, and I'm laying there screaming, asking somebody to help my granddaughter because he just shot her in the head. And he wouldn't even help her. They turned on the light and seen that she had been shot and killed at the house.
What if a white teenager was arrested by a black cop and placed in his squad car with his hands cuffed behind his back, and while in police custody, the white teenager is shot and killed, and the black officers claim he committed suicide, even though they could not find the gun and have been searched twice, and the police claim they did a thorough search before even placing him in the vehicle? What if a black police officer unloaded more than 100 bullets into a car, killing both a white female and white male passenger because they thought they heard shots coming from their car, only to find out there was no gun present? What if white people, after going through centuries of abuse at the hands of black people, were accused of being hateful racists for merely bringing up the truth about the slavery, lynching, hangings, raping, torture, discrimination, murder, Jim Crow laws, thievery, invasions, castrations, burnings, and almost total annihilation of some white populations at the hands of black people? What if after centuries of slavery, murder, thievery, and destruction against white people by blacks, whites were met with a nonchalant attitude by present-day black people whose ancestors have done all of this heinous mess to white people for centuries, covered up their crimes, lied about their deeds, excused their actions, and still continue to this day to do the same things and have the same behavior against innocent white people, and they simply tell white people to just get over it?
The scriptures talk about the world being given into the hands of the wicked. Well, who is this wicked? Does the scripture describe the wicked?
The wicked in his pride doth persecute the poor. Let them be taken in the devices that they have imagined. For the wicked boasteth of his heart's desire, and blesseth the covetous, whom the Lord abhorreth. The wicked through the pride of his countenance will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. His ways are always grievous. Thy judgments are far above out of his sight. As for all his enemies, he puffeth at them. He hath said in his heart, I shall not be moved, for I shall never be in adversity. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and fraud. Under his tongue is mischief and vanity. He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret places doth he murder the innocent. His eyes are privily set against the poor. He lieth in wait secretly as a lion in his den. He lieth in wait to catch the poor. He doth catch the poor when he draweth him into his net. He croucheth and humbleth himself, that the poor may fall by his strong ones. He hath said in his heart, God hath forgotten. He hideth his face, he will never see it.
Now, who does this sound like to you? Come on, I want you to say it. Who does this sound like to you? In his pride doeth he persecute the poor. This is the wicked is describing here. In his pride he persecuteth the poor. He boasteth of his heart's desire. The scripture says that Yah's judgments are far out of his sight. Out of whose sight? The wicked. That means the wicked has no sense of judgment. Look at this judicial court system we have today. Look at how they're misjudging Yah's people. They have no sense of true righteous judgment whatsoever. Look at the system. The system is flawed, it's crooked. because you have a wicked people running the system. The wicked said in his heart, I shall not be moved, for I shall never be in adversity. Now who says that? Huh? Who speaks like that in their heart, in the heart of their pride? It also said that the wicked's mouth is full of cursing, deceit, and fraud. Who goes across the planet using deceit and fraud, mischief, huh? To steal lands from people. It says under his tongue is what? Mischief and vanity. Now, look at this verse here. It says he sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. And in the secret places do if he murder the innocent. His eyes are privily set against the poor. Now who is this that's running the show today? Huh? Whose eyes are privily against the poor? Huh? They are against the poor. The wicked lieth in wait secretly as a lion in his den. Look at the scriptures. The scriptures is literally trying to tell you who this wicked is going to be. It's literally telling you who he is. Huh? He lieth in wait to catch the poor. He doeth catch the poor, and when he draweth him into his net, what does he do? He kills him. That's what he does. That's what the scripture says. He murders him. You see that? He murders him. Now look at this poor kid that just come out in the news. This kid that was hung on a swing in North Carolina. He goes out in the middle of the night just walking, and the next thing you know, they find him hanging from a swing. Huh? That's the wicked that done caught him. You see that? He's lurking about in secret places just waiting for some lonely poor person just come walking along so he can kill him. You see that? It's in the word. He have said in his heart, God has forgotten. That's just like the wicked. They go out and they do all the wickedness, and then they sit back and they look around and say, man, we've been doing this for thousands of years. And God hasn't judged us. He hasn't done anything. He's for us. He has forgotten, huh? He has hidden his face, and he will never see it. Now, I want to ask you, who is this wicked man, huh, that the scripture's talking about? You tell me, huh? Go and ask the Native Americans who this wicked man is. Go and ask the Arabs. Ask the people of South Africa. Or go and ask the Aboriginals that's in Australia who this wicked man is. I'm quite sure they have an answer for you. The scriptures talks about how in the last days this wicked beast and his people is going to come and destroy the earth.
Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, which was diverse from all the others, exceeding dreadful, whose teeth were of iron, and his nails of brass, which devoured, brake in pieces, and stamped the residue with his feet, and of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, and before whom 3 fell. Even of that horn that had eyes and a mouth that spake very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints, and prevailed against them, until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down, and break it in pieces. And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise, and another shall rise after them, and he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue 3 kings. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time.
Who is this fourth beast that the scriptures talk about? It's the Roman Empire, modern Rome. This empire is going to devour the whole earth and tread it down and break it into pieces. Who is this people that's content with destroying the whole earth?
Who am I?
The scripture states that you judge a tree by its fruit. The Messiah said that a corrupt tree will have corrupt fruit. For the tree is known by his fruit.
Who am I?
If this tree were to represent a people, then we could simply look at the fruit and determine if they're wicked or not.
Who am I?
What people are destroying the planet with their wicked inventions?
Who am I?
They have left a trail of murder, theft, and destruction all over the earth.
Who am I?
This is a corrupt fruit from a corrupt people.
When you look at movies like Rosewood and To Kill a Mockingbird, historically you have always had white women to claim that a black man has raped her. All she had to do was say it. No investigation, no type of proof of anything. A white mob would not just go after that one man who they perceived to do a crime. In many cases, there was no crime committed, but she said it was. So you would have a white mob go out and hunt any black person. It didn't matter if it was a child, a woman, the man who they thought did the crime, or any person. Any person that was black would have been hit or killed or lynched by a white mob. And now, what you have today are black men going after white women straightway like an ox to the slaughter.
With my fair speech, I caused you to yield. With the flattering of my lips, I forced you. You come after me as an ox to the slaughter, till a dart strike through your liver as a bird trapped in a snare, and knows not that it is for your life. Don't let your heart decline to my ways. Do not come in my paths, for I have cast down many wounded, and many strong men have been slain by me. My house is the way to hell, going down the chambers of death.
Look at what I did to the Native Americans. I killed millions of them and took their land, and gave them back the worst land in the country. I made several treaties with them and broke every one of them. Everywhere I go, I wreak havoc, and I use lies to get into other nations. In Iraq, I knew there were no weapons of mass destruction. In Libya and Syria, I sent the rebels to disrupt their counties and overthrow their government. I called the terrorists when I was the one doing it to them. I went to many nations stealing their natural resources, killing millions of people throughout history. I even erased the facts from history so many would be blind to it. Yes, I covered my tracks well. I've killed 100 million Native Americans, 100 million African Hebrews in the transatlantic slave trade, 10 million in the Congo Africa from 1885 to 1908, 200,000 Maya people, 900,000 Australian Aboriginals, and the list goes on and on. Now I plan to depopulate the entire earth, and you don't even see it coming. Who am I?
I am Edom.
I am Edom.
I am Edom. Ah ha ha ha.
How are the things of Esau searched out? How are his hidden things sought up?
You've just been given a brief history of the forgotten past of the national shame of America. The thing is, white citizens did do these things to black people. These things so horrible and with such treachery that it doesn't even seem real. These things actually occurred at a time where it was not shameful to do these things, where it wasn't racist to murder black people. But now, because of political correctness, it is viewed as shameful and is now hidden under the legal umbrella of police brutality and stand your ground laws. The legal system has made it possible again for whites to do as they please to black citizens and not have to fear the shame of committing these heinous crimes. Racist whites use the news media, movies, music, books, cartoons, or whatever means necessary to make it seem as though all blacks are just violent, ignorant, useless, three-fifths humans that deserve any kind of torture they can give us. Most whites today simply ignore the brutality against black people of both the past and the present. They feel that things of the past should be forgotten and things of the present are our own faults, and we can't connect their past violence against us to the present. Case in point, the murdering of Trayvon Martin by a white Latino man and the countless police murders of unarmed black men. There's no need to try to convince a racist that they are racist because they're comfortable in hating others who are different. No matter how bad the crime against a black person is, racist whites will find a way to justify the killing. Even to those who don't condone racial killings, your silence is your approval. The more things change, the more they stay the same. And the beneficiaries of white privilege don't want to rock the boat of privilege, even if it means that others must suffer to maintain their privilege. We want to make it clear that we don't feel that all white people reflect the views spoken of in this documentary. And not all white people feel this type of extreme hatred for others. We know that many strongly oppose the acts of their ancestors and even frown upon the oppression and brutality we see today. Our message is meant to educate those who seem to be blind to the reasons why so many are feeling frustrations toward those who continue to persecute, murder, and abuse the same people they have abused for centuries, and use the same system to find themselves not guilty. The world is growing increasingly tired of those abuses and are now calling on those who are complicit with this behavior to make a choice between good and evil, or stand before the Almighty God in judgment.
History made it a mystery. In order to get victory, you had to keep it buried. We run a background check and find out you're a wreck. You've been hiding all this mess that you wanted us to forget. You never ever will confess to what you try to suppress. Pretending that you are perfect, but what you do to reflect? And that I expect you to come more than admit, cause you will keep on insisting that you are innocent, not repenting.
From school to the time that we grew up and got old, you never told us that you cause came to what a blow. You understood the fact you had a lot to hide if you were gonna mentally enslave the rest of the world. You see, you had to resort the trickery to gain victory, taking the liberty of the indigenous population, taking over the nations, enslaving the natives, colonization of the continent with laws of subjugation, leading inhabitants into submission, intimidation, using mental breakers, moving deception to the people, using Christianity, taking the truth and distorting it into a false religion, tricking the world and facing the ancient pictures, replacing them with false depictions to hide the truth from the future generations, making it non-existent, to make us ignorant, to keep you innocent, to keep the evidence from us in your defense, to leave us unaware.
You hid your history, made created a mystery. In order to get victory, you had to keep it buried. We read a background check, if I thought you were wreck. You've been hiding all this mess that you wouldn't ask to forget. You never ever will confess to what you try to suppress. Pretending that you are perfect, but what you do to reflect. Not that I expect you to come more than admit. Cause you will keep on insisting that you are innocent, not repenting.
Mass murdering people across the planet.
Genocides in the past, I can't live in the present. Raping the women to bring it down, I'm here to take it then. Defense evading, use the guns as a way to stay them. Exterminating the population, confiscation of the lands. Still the forgetting and destroying innocent lives. Persecuting the people that fought back. A conqueror with no honor, you brought death. You went around the world with an army to make slaughter. You sought to find a way to get away with massacre of the aboriginal. Undespeakable, unforgivable, criminal deed. The mastermind behind the crime, yet you had a nerd to stereotype. You criminalize and criticize, was trying to emphasize you're on the good side. Silence it, the people that you victimize. Talk about morality, a fallacy in my eyes. Conversation for slavery. What would you think if my grandfather brought your family and passed the riches down to me? And you were poor, looking at my family, living the dream you wish you had. All the money that we stole from you and gave you nothing back. If the tables were to turn, you probably wouldn't be able to take it. Face it, never been able to be paid. You told us to be grateful until this day, going out your way to make our life pain. Making it seem like it's in our mind, nothing to remind. Something in the past, doing it in the present, taking away from us on a daily basis and blaming us for our situation that you put us in position. You intended, but you pretend not to have anything to do with it, but you're doing it. Made it a mystery. In order to get victory, you had to keep it buried. We run a background check. If I thought you were a wreck, you've been hiding all this mess that you wouldn't ask to forget. You never ever will confess to what you try to suppress. Pretending that you are perfect, but what you do to reflect. Not that I expect you to come more than admit. Cause you will keep on insisting that you are innocent. Never pretend. Background check.